So I'm Rochelle Dreyfuss, and I teach here and at patent law, international IP law, and IP crimes. So we haven't talked about criminal IP cases at all. Let me introduce the panel. Colleen Chien teaches at Santa Clara Law School and just came off a stint as the White House Senior Advisor for Intellectual Property and Innovation. Among many other things, she does comparative empirical research on various procedural issues and patent law. David Schwartz, Mark's next. We're doing it alphabetically. So you've already seen Mark in action, professor at Stanford, leading litigator, prolific author, and consummate video game player. So you've already seen him. And then David Schwartz teaches at Northwestern, where he conducts empirical research on issues in patent litigation, writes with Mark, and also about patent litigants. And so we have lots of people who've done procedural stuff on this panel to help digest all the wonderful stuff we heard about this morning. So I'm going to start with this. I clerked for Warren Berger, and Berger was an Anglophile, and he used to invite English jurists to sit with him on the bench and very much envied procedural things in England. And was, of course, then against the civil jury because England had abolished it. And he wanted to do that, too. In 1979, he gave some remarks at the annual meeting of the Chief Justices, which were entitled Remarks, Use of Lay Jurors in Complicated Civil Cases, in which he advocated getting rid of civil juries in complicated cases. And in several later pieces, he also wrote about just getting rid of civil juries entirely. There was a lot of brushback amongst the public about that, with the idea that the Seventh Amendment, of course, is a guarantee of an important right. But I think that some of his concerns actually were absorbed by the Supreme Court. And in the years at the end of his tenure and in the years afterwards, we got a whole lot of cases which took things away from the jury and put the judge in the gatekeeping role. So easier to get summary judgment and solo attacks against Catrett and Anderson and Liberty Lobby and Matsushita against Zenith, the bar on junk science and Daubert against Merrill Dow, which somebody mentioned earlier today, harsher pleading requirements and Bell Atlantic against Twombly, Ashcroft against Iqbal. In patent cases, we've already talked a lot about Markman against Westview. But I'd also put the categorical exclusions of Bilski, Mayo, Myriad, and Alice in that camp because it seems to have facilitated summary judgment in some cases. So he really wanted to get rid of the civil jury, and partly he was successful, I think. Fewer cases go through a full trial. But what I thought we saw in the data that Mark presented and that Maggie presented earlier today is that partly it was a failure because more of the cases that go to trial seem to go to a jury trial. But I was wondering whether in this smaller group of cases, you know, apart from the Hatch-Waxman cases, whether there are differences in the kinds of cases. So this was sort of partly Scott's question about whether there are selection effects in these cases and whether that's part of what's causing the problem. Is it the choice of cases? Is it who's bringing them? Dave, you want to start us off on this?
Sure. I guess, you know, when I look at this, some of those cases that you mentioned are kind of part of the broader trend that the Supreme Court has had, taking away issues or making it easier for the court to resolve all civil litigation. And there's been a literature for at least a generation about the vanishing civil trial, so not really about patent trials. But as I kind of look back at the data on patent cases and even I look back at the data from the Administrative Office of Courts, there hasn't been a time since the records are available from the early 90s, where more than 5% of the adjudications in patent cases were decided by juries. And so I don't think this has been something that's been, you know, only a recent trend and only a patent trend. This is kind of probably more broadly understood as just what's happening in civil litigation. I do think that it's also useful to kind of separate out those Hatch-Waxman cases, which are different for a whole bunch of different reasons, including that a jury isn't available. So it's not that people are opting out of a jury, but people don't have the right to a jury. But I just think the bigger kind of issue is there's just this long-term trend that there aren't that many jury trials. And that's kind of a civil litigation trend more than a patent litigation.
So I just want to sort of jump in with one other point here, because patent law is interesting in this respect because of the history. Most of us, I suspect, have sort of lived with our entire careers with a world in which a patent trial is mostly going to be a jury trial outside of ANDA cases. That's not how it was for most of American history. And in fact, between the 1870s and the 1970s, virtually no patent trials were before juries. It was less than 5%. Despite a bunch of changes in the system, there are some historical reasons for that. I've got a paper that may be available to you all on the website that was published a couple of years ago that walks through the history. But the result of that, I think, is that one of the things that has happened, and Dave may well be right that these are sort of happening contemporaneous in time and it's not causally related, but as you see the rise of the trial, meaning a jury trial rather than a bench trial, I think you are more likely to see judges deciding things pre-trial, either that this is not a case that's appropriate to send to a jury trial, or that this part of the case needs to be cabined in certain respects. We see today that district judges are more likely to go to trial in ANDA cases. That's in part because of who the parties are and what their incentives are to settle or not settle, but it's also because a district judge who knows that they are going to try the case at the end of the day is less likely to go out of their way to resolve summary judgment issues because they can just sort of wait and see what the evidence presents. And so I think one of the reasons we actually see fewer patent trials today may be related to the fact that they are more likely to be jury trials rather than bench trials.
And I think what's also important to keep in mind is not really judge versus jury trial, but trial or resolution earlier. What I thought was striking about the data from Lex Machina and looking at this 2019 to current period is that even though we've had almost a doubling, or I think it is a doubling, of the number of cases, the proportion of cases that go to trial is getting smaller. So among those, juries are still a healthy share, the majority, but the overall number of cases going to trial is fewer. So, you know, that to me implies that there is more competition, and we've certainly seen that, whether it be domestically through IPR and the PTAB resolving cases, or internationally with other fora being faster, or even the ITC providing another forum. You know, in terms of that as a resolution, or even thinking about within the case, having the case be resolved earlier, the competition, the trial is not winning in terms of that competition. And so I think that raises some questions for, is the jury contributing to kind of trial losing out as a resolution on the merits? And is that something that we need to consider more fully?
So you mean that people choose not to, people would rather resolve it early than have to face a jury?
I think, you know, we've talked a lot about direct democracy and the importance of juries. I think we also need to think about the importance of the interests of litigants and their desire for certainty and resolution. Often when you're talking about a company that is, you know, has, you know, many things going on, but the trial has the potential, or the patent litigation has the potential to really impact the overall outcome and the outlook of the company, they would rather have an earlier resolution, more certainty. And so they're going to the court because they can't, as two parties, decide and come to a meeting of the minds on how strong the merits of the case are. So they're looking for some sort of resolution from some adjudicatory body. And that can come in the form of, you know, summary judgment or early claim construction. But now we have IPR, we have the ITC, we have other jurisdictions that can render some judgment. And that may be enough then to kind of provoke the settlement. So I do think that competition more broadly is a dynamic that is changing.
So the ones that are left seem to go to jury trial more often than bench trial. So do we have a theory for why that's the case? Is it that the received wisdom and now the data show that the patentee more often wins, or are there other effects going on here?
Well, so I guess I have a few thoughts. One is that I think that most of the cases that could go to a jury trial do go to a jury trial. The point that Mark raised, I think, is really interesting and one that's kind of perplexed me for a long time, which is why in the 1970s did plaintiffs in particular not ask for jury trials in patent cases? And I think that is correct that they did not. And then there was kind of a big shift that occurred by the 90s. And I'm not sure if that shift was because people had different perceptions of juries, or whether it was because, you know, general practice lawyers got involved in patent cases, but that's kind of a mystery. But there has been a change, and I think now almost all of the cases that could go to a jury, not all, but almost all, there's a demand for a jury.
So have you looked at the lawyers'
That's coming, right.
So, right. So a lot of people shifted over from antitrust law. As antitrust law died, their comparative advantage was trying cases to a jury, perhaps. Right.
Dave has done work on the rise of contingency fee litigation in IP, right?
Right.
So that's clearly a jury-focused bar, right? And it is. You're right to say that sort of, you know, we saw general practice lawyers come in. Right, people whose skill is in trying cases, not litigating patent cases, and that's a different group of people. Right.
But I would kind of press a little bit on the assumption, and I think Mark's survey will really help us understand whether this is happening, that if a plaintiff can go to the jury, they will. Because as we heard, it's more expensive, and anecdotally talking to a couple of folks in the audience, and then what we heard also in the exchange is that it can cost 2 times more, or maybe even more than that, to bring a jury trial versus a trial in front of the bench. And part of the information that Mark revealed earlier about how these cases are scheduled, that if you're going to have 6 days continuous versus 2 hours here, 4 hours there, that flexibility that's available in a bench trial is not really quite there with a jury, because you really need to prioritize the juries, as mentioned by Judge Gilstrap, doctor's appointments, real life. They need to be able to have this trial in a compressed format, so it is going to be more expensive. And so if you are a plaintiff deciding, should I gamble and go for higher costs, but hopefully a higher chance of recovery, but not necessarily, looking at what district you're in, the marginal chance of winning isn't necessarily going to be that much higher. Is it actually worth it? It would depend on the stakes in the case and whether that certain expense of having to pay for a jury trial is worth the, upside of additional chance that you might win and you might get a favorable judgment.
Can I just jump in for a second? And one thing I want to, we've talked a few times about the win rate comparison between bench and jury trials, and I actually am not very convinced that that's a good measure, both because I think the ANDA cases are so different, but also because once there's a jury demand, that's going to affect which cases settle. Like, that's going to affect both the plaintiff and the defendant's views on what's going to happen. And so the kind of path to settlement might be different. And so, as I just kind of think outside of patent law, the kind of general plaintiff view is that they want a jury. And, I'm not sure if that's, fully justified empirically, but that's kind of the conventional wisdom is, the plaintiff should ask for a jury.
So how about the composition of the law firms? So we've seen the death of all of the boutique law firms. Now we have these large practice firms. Do you think that makes a difference? There's just more, folks there to do the jury trial?
Maybe, although, I think I think general practice versus IP specialty does, general practice lawyers tend to be more comfortable in a courtroom in front of a jury, although the big versus small firm, I think, may go in different directions, right? Big firms are used to litigating cases more than they are trying cases in some respects, right? I mean, they're the firms that are going to sort of paper, here are 12 summary judgment motions and pick the one you like best, judge, and a lot of the kind of growth in litigation intensiveness and cost of patent litigation over the last couple of decades, right, may well be associated with kind of bigger firms being involved.
And how about the rise of the non-practicing entity?
I definitely think that first a lot of those, but maybe not all of those, are represented on a contingent basis. And I do think how the lawyer is compensated has an effect on what cases settle and what cases kind of proceed. And so I think that is, kind of an important factor. And if Mark's, interested in studying that, that's a difficult thing to get at, right? I mean, that relationship is usually, attorney-client privileged and difficult to get at.
And it would seem like on that front, if a contingent fee lawyer is looking at funding a jury trial versus a bench, I mean, they have to spend out of pocket costs for expert time and additional kind of things that are not just their own time that they have to pay for. So I'm wondering if you think that for contingent fee lawyers, the dynamic is pretty different, where they're having to put up the money for the jury trial versus,
well,
you know,
and there's financing, of course.
Right, and so, right, so there could be third-party financing that covers the costs.
Okay.
But, you know, as I just think of, like, when somebody's filing a case, and I'd be interested, you know, to hear people in the room that actually, you know, do this a little more. But, you know, the cost of the trial is only one component of it, the cost of actually, like, being at trial. And there's a long process before that, and I'm not sure that, you know, the added expense, you know, whatever added expense there would be from a jury trial would substantially affect the calculus.
And how about the existence of the Federal Circuit? So the jury trials seemed to go up around the same time that the Federal Circuit got created, and there's at least some argument that it's maybe easier to review a bench trial than it is a jury trial's verdict.
Well, so there's definitely been a change in the law around this, and I think it's clearly the rise of jury trials starts before the creation of the Federal Circuit, but the first wave of kind of cases that are presenting, well, what is it a jury's entitled to get, start to hit right about the creation of the Federal Circuit. Early, so the regional circuit cases pretty much, they do different things, but all of them, before the creation of the Federal Circuit, limit the role of a jury in ways that you would find shocking today. And basically, the choice between the different regional circuits was a choice between, okay, we'll give the jury the validity question, but it's purely an advisory question, and the judge has to understand that the jury's verdict has no legal force. Some circuits, including the Ninth Circuit, said that. Other circuits, including the Seventh Circuit, said, well, you can give the jury only specific subsidiary factual questions. We don't even think it's permissible to give the jury an advisory verdict on validity because the judge is likely to be influenced by it. And so all you can do is you can ask them specific subsidiary factual questions. What's the level of skill in the art? In this art, was the, you know,
so special
verdicts? Yes, special verdicts. Were secondary considerations present or so forth? And indeed, very early Federal Circuit opinions also take this form and throw out even a general jury verdict form on obviousness. And that gradually starts to change in the 1980s, and not really with any kind of one precedential decision saying, no, no, that's not the rule, we are departing from those regional circuit rules, but simply with affirmance of kind of more and more general verdicts that include validity and infringement, and it comes to be the accepted way in which we do these things.
Does that promote jury trials?
I think it does promote jury trials as well. So here's the advantage. Here's the way in which I think it kind of drives jury trials. Right, if all I have is a verdict, then both as a legal doctrinal matter under Federal Circuit precedent, but also as a practical matter, it's hard to kind of pick that apart and know what to do. And so you give it deference or you don't give it deference. And Judge O'Malley talked this morning about circumstances in which the Federal Circuit has been criticized for not giving enough deference to finders of fact. But I think if you've got a verdict that says this patent is valid and that's all it says, or even this patent is non-obvious and that's all it says, the judges are gonna sort of bend over backwards to uphold that, in part because they can't actually parse it out. If you give them instead, here are some specific factual determinations, and the district judge then has to write an articulated set of reasons why those facts put together mean that the patent is obvious or non-obvious, I think the appellate court feels like it's on much firmer ground in reviewing and analyzing those arguments. They know why the decision was made, and they may be more likely to disagree with it.
Do you want to add something?
You know, the only thing I was going to add was that there are these kind of changes in the law that sometimes affect litigant behavior. The other thing is sometimes there are, you know, specific events that are in the news, and so there was a big verdict that was a jury verdict, I think, that was involving Kodak and Polaroid in the, like, I think the early 90s, that was in the high nine figures, and so people, like, took notes
of the lawyers in that case in the room.
I think it was a lot earlier. It was a lot.
Was it a jury trial, Pat?
Was
Okay, so we're the academic panel, so of course we have to ask the normative questions, right? So what is the effect of having most of the cases that get litigated decided in a jury trial as opposed to a bench trial? So first question, I think perhaps about the question of whether you go back to the question of this morning, is there a constitutional right to a trial by jury on validity?
So this is something I've done a lot of studying on, and the answer is it's complicated. So the first thing to know is that, bizarrely, we actually don't have an answer to this question in the law. We had a case from the Federal Circuit in 1995 in Ray Lockwood that presented this issue squarely. Three judges said there is a constitutional right to have a jury decide validity issues. Three other judges wrote a dissent from denial of rehearing en banc in which they said, no, there is no such right. The Supreme Court granted cert, whereupon the patent plaintiff decided they didn't want a jury after all, withdrew the jury demand, and then under the voluntary cessation doctrine, because the plaintiff had basically killed off their own victory, the case was not it was not just dismissed as moot, it was actually affirmatively vacated. And so there is no actual binding precedent on the question. There are a couple of cases in the Federal Circuit that in dictum have said, we read Lockwood and the panel opinion seems persuasive to us, even though it's not precedential. There are several cases that have sort of found no right to a jury trial in various specialized circumstances. So in AGFA versus CREO, they said no right to have a jury determine the facts that could be the basis of inequitable conduct, even though they're also the basis of validity. There's a case involving the ANDA cases that says it's equity, not law. If you go back to what the U.S. Supreme Court might do, I am not a Seventh Amendment scholar. I'm a patent guy. But from what I can tell, there are several different strands of Seventh Amendment jurisprudence. There are the what happened in England before 1791 people. And what happened in England before 1791 is complicated in its own right, but you would probably say that, you know what, at least some of what we are thinking of today as validity determinations were being heard in the common law courts in front of juries. Though the most analogous form of attack on a patent, it was the Syrophasius doctrine, which allowed you to revoke a patent, was actually something done in the chancery courts, not in the law courts. But I think you could tell a story that there's a right to a jury trial based on British behavior before 1791. On the other hand, other Seventh Amendment law has looked at the public rights doctrine, which was mentioned a little bit this morning. The Supreme Court is particularly fond of referring to patent law as a doctrine imbued with the public interest, to invalidation of bad patents as a public right. And if they believe that approach, I think they're unlikely to say that that's something that can be given to the jury, because public rights need to be vindicated by legal rulings and not simply by juries. And there's also the administrative law aspect. So in other areas of administrative law, the Supreme Court has said there's no Seventh Amendment right to a jury trial challenging the determination of an administrative agency, even in circumstances where that determination gets applied in court in a way that causes me affirmative harm. This issue will go to the Supreme Court eventually. It might go to the Supreme Court eventually in a kind of motion to strike a jury demand in court. It may more likely get to the Supreme Court in short order with some of the constitutional challenges to the IPR proceedings that have been raised. I think if the Supreme Court takes up those challenges, it is likely to say, based on its administrative law jurisprudence, nonsense. There's no Seventh Amendment right to have a jury review what any other administrative agency has done, and that might actually sort of affect the path of jury trials in patent cases quite substantially.
Yeah, so I'm not a historian, nor am I even going to pretend to be one here. Instead, what I want to...
An amateur historian.
I'm not even going to pretend to be an amateur historian. I think that, to me, I'm interested in, like, kind of practicalities and whether the jury is competent enough at least maybe not compared to the best district court judge, but to compare it to like an average district court judge. And when I think of like the challenges, you know, the two really big challenges to me are jury instructions. Okay, so jury instructions are just often written by lawyers for lawyers and not well enough. And then the kind of differences in jury selection, the way that we pick juries, and that varies court by court. But I do think that juries have two distinct advantages over judges. And one of them we talked about a little bit earlier, which is there's just huge benefits from having a group decide things rather than a single decision maker, that the kind of biases can be canceled out. It's more likely that there's somebody that has some knowledge of science or of accounting or just a bunch of different backgrounds.
Struck?
Well, I mean, that's a question, but I do think that the kind of pool, and especially having 12, and I agree with the kind of comment earlier that 12 is better than 6, more is better. And then the kind of second advantage that the jury has is that there's some psychology literature that would suggest that that nobody is immune to the effects of inadmissible evidence, and that includes judges. And so if a judge hears evidence, or anybody hears evidence that's, for instance, more prejudicial than probative, that you can't unring that bell. And so there's been a bunch of studies where judges are given, are randomly assigned into groups, and some of them are given, evidence that wouldn't be admissible, and they're told is not admissible, and those judges reach decisions that it seems like is influenced by the inadmissible evidence that's given to them. We have a system that's set up for the jury where we have motions in limine and sidebars, et cetera, to really preclude the jury from hearing that evidence, while the system is set up that the judge, is the kind of the person trying the case is always going to be confronted with that.
So I think one question, just to go a little bit more to the normative issue, and again, I also am not a historian or someone who studies Seventh Amendment law, but in preparing for today, I did come across the original justification for juries, and if we're going to talk about the old English courts, the real fear, as I understand it, was that colonists were concerned that English lawyers that were appointed by the king to preside over cases would really be interested in imperial law, law that would kind of reinforce the monarchy. And so the jury was needed as a check against the judge and against the process where the judges appointed by, again, the king would reinforce what was best for the monarchy. And so we created the jury system where we promulgated that within the United States to provide a hedge against the bias of judges. And I don't see that as still a concern, but it raises the normative question of, do we think judges or juries are more accurate? Mark presented information that shows that the outcomes that they come to, still highly selected, but maybe not completely apples to apples, certainly is a perception that juries are more favorable to patentees. And David suggests perhaps the reasons why juries are better, because more minds are better than one at coming to the answer. And I don't know if there's actually a research from either of you or others about the appeal rate and whether or not judges or jury outcomes or appeal to reverse more often. But I know in a small sample that we looked at, just looking at damages for a project I'm doing with Tom Cotter, and we looked at damages outcomes, and we did find that juries were, their decisions and were remanded more often, but not because the amount was wrong more often, but because they were finding in favor for the validity of the patent more often. So I don't know if that's consistent overall, that juries, not only are they more favorable towards patentees, but they are in a way that is reversed more often than the judges' decisions on validity.
Yeah, I don't know if you can tease those two out. So it is the case that the Federal Circuit, it changes over time, which is part of the problem. I think the Federal Circuit sort of today, it is more likely to reverse a pro-patent district court decision than an anti-patent one. That didn't used to be true. And then, of course, because there are more likely
juries,
to be jury
right.
Verdicts that are pro-patent, so it may be that there are more jury verdict reversals, but that it might be explained by other data. So I'm not sure there's a...
I think the reason it matters is because of the bigger picture question of thinking about the incentive to innovate that the patent system is really designed for. And wondering, you know, again, I think here's where we actually need to step away from the empirics and think more about the perception. What does it do to the person who was going to be innovating to know that there may be an 8, 9, 10-figure verdict potentially out there for them, regardless of whether or not they're successful in the marketplace? If they can find that this is actually a very successful invention, is this something that then kind of fuels and provides fuel to the genius of innovators to go forward and innovate and be more vigorous in their pursuit of innovation? And so I think we need to step back and think about that question of if we associate having juries present in our system with a higher chance of the patent being enforced and having a big outcome, and that does capture the imagination of the press and of the general media and also of the general public, and people do see, yeah, I can have a very successful pathway as an inventor, I'm going to go for it. You know, maybe that is something that we do want to encourage. You know, you want to think about marginally, isn't that person going to be also looking at wanting to be in the market and be very successful? And what are we exactly incenting? Are we incenting the innovation, or are we incenting that they have a really good lawyer too, so that if they don't, you know, succeed in the marketplace, they can also pursue, if they, you know, of course, things are not mutually exclusive, but you can also pursue rewards in the court. So I think that that is, you know, the underlying question that we need to all be grappling with, especially on this panel, is the question of what do juries represent to kind of the would-be innovator, and, you know, is it actually incenting the right behavior, or is it incenting kind of better lawyering versus actually more innovation?
So I think I'm more skeptical than Colleen of the sort of connection being drawn there. Not the sort of patent innovation story, but that, well, the fact that I'm going to get a jury rather than a judge 12 years from now, after my patent has been applied for and then issued 4 years after that, and then I found some infringers and then I sued them, and then I got all the way to the trial, even though 95% of them settle. There's an awful long causal story, right?
That's got to be second generation, the potential infringer who might be hit.
It turns out if you're an innovator, you might be the plaintiff in your nine-figure verdict, but you might also be the defendant in your nine-figure verdict, right? Because most of them are innovators too. So I'm a little less skeptical of that. I kind of think of the practicalities of it in a somewhat different way, right? Which is, are we getting kind of as good or better decisions, right, out of a jury, right? Now, what evidence do we have of that? Of course, it's hard to know in some abstract sense, right, you know, who's right. It is the case that most district judges will tell you juries get it right. It seems to me a useful data point. It is the case, I think, as Kelly has mentioned, is somewhat more expensive to have a jury trial than a bench trial. But I also think that one of the things we ought to be paying attention to is what is it that juries are particularly good at, and what is it in patent cases that translates to, right? So I think juries in ordinary civil cases, juries in criminal cases, are really good at telling truth tellers from liars, right? I think the group dynamic makes that happen. I think the just sort of sitting and watching people makes that happen. But it may be that for most of the what we care about in patent law, that's less important than it is in other areas of civil or criminal law, right? That is, most of what we care about is not, wow, this is an expert who's lying. Although I think, you know, there certainly are such circumstances. So that might suggest, well, maybe the jury has less of a comparative advantage in patent cases than they do in other kinds of cases. It may be that the jury has advantages in particular substantive questions, right? That there are things we actually want the jury to resolve. Inventorship disputes seems to me an obvious example of such a dispute. Inequitable conduct disputes seems to me an obvious example. Interestingly, those are things we don't give to the jury in patent law, even though they're arguably things that sort of are precisely within the juror's competence. And it may be that damages is such a case too. Damages is a kind of hard question because it too gets bound up with sort of experts and their models. I think the case for a Seventh Amendment right to a jury trial in patent cases is most rock solid when it comes to evaluating damages. I think a lot of economists would like that not to be the rule, but I think it seems pretty clear that that's the place there is going to be evaluation. So we might then think about, all right, what issues should we be giving to the jury? Not do we throw the whole case to the jury, right? But are there specific questions on which having a jury that can actually figure out the facts that are relevant to a particular patent question will help us?
Yeah, so the one thing that I guess to steer the conversation a little differently, I guess one thing to think about in my mind is, you know, are there certain areas where the jury is biased and biased relative to the court and in a way that we think is like unfair? And if so, then that's something that we should like think about trying to either like root out in some way. And so when I, you know, I haven't studied the like empirical literature on this, although I've talked to others about the kind of general civil litigation jury predisposition. And I think there's some evidence that back in like the day, like the 1950s and 60s, the kind of general jury pool, if it was just given a, we have no facts, who do you favor, plaintiff or defendant, was inclined to favor the plaintiff. There was a huge PR, I'm just talking civil litigation. And there was a big PR push by the Chamber of Commerce and others to talk about frivolous cases and the cost to business, and that is evened out. And there's actually a lot of people that come into a jury room saying, I favor the defendant. And so in the medical malpractice context, there's been some empirical studies where they've looked, and actually the jury and the kind of expert decision maker agree most of the time, and when they don't, usually the jury finds no liability, where the expert would have found liability. Now pulling it back to patents, you know, one thing that Judge Young said was this validity issue, that there's a concern that the jury might, you know, just not want to second guess the patent office. And I think there's some evidence in the past that there might be some truth to that, that the jury really, you know, says if an expert agency decided this, then who am I to question this? I think that we've seen in the last 5 years a lot of press about the patent system that's mainly negative, about cases are frivolous, the patents are all invalid. And so I think it's an open question what people's views are right now, but I'm not sure that a jury that comes in is going to be pro plaintiff in a patent case.
So Colleen, you've studied a lot of foreign cases, and particularly I know Germany, and there's no juries there. So is there anything to be learned from that?
Well, I think it's an interesting question, especially with respect to the issue of damages. So the short answer is that other countries don't use juries to decide patent cases. They don't use them in a lot of contexts. And I think one of the issues is, what does that do to the cost of litigation? What does that do to overall the determination of then what the case is worth? And certainly the cost of litigation has a lot to do with more the civil versus common law systems, discovery, and issues that are not kind of germane to judge versus jury per se. But I do think, you can ask the question again of going back to court competition. If I can get some adjudication on the merits of something that the parties just cannot themselves see eye to eye on in other jurisdictions at a cheaper price earlier, then that often is going to be a pretty useful input and helpful for settlement discussions. And so these other, I was just in India, and the court there has not been particularly quick, but they're now giving more priority to patent cases and are trying to decide them in a 6-month period. You know, we certainly have a lot of variation domestically with the different courts and how quickly they can resolve cases. But you do, I think, in these other jurisdictions have now the ability to provide a fairly quick outcome. So if you want to go to Germany or you just get some information on infringement or nullity, or you know, there are more options to do that. But I think the question of damages is one that is important. And again, this is where we are outlier, or maybe we're, you know, other countries are depressed in their damages assessments. But even adjusting for GDP, and it's hard, again, to make kind of apples-to-apples comparisons because each technology is worth something different and in different jurisdictions, different markets. But we do have damages that are at a lot higher level than compared to other countries. And one question is whether or not the jury system really contributes to that. And particularly, I think, in the question of component liability, and Mark and others have written about royalty stacking, and this question of trying to figure out and ask a jury this very, very hard question. You know, we know that juries get things right, and we've heard that theme, but particularly the very difficult question of how to value a small component that's part of a big product. And it sounds fairly innocuous to say this is just worth a small fraction, you know, 1% of the value of the entire market, which is billions of dollars, but that ends up being a very, very big number. And I do think in that, in those contexts, that it, what, to the extent that juries are used, judges need to really be careful about what they hear. And, you know, there's been more attention now to kind of comparable licenses and making sure that the evidence is really solid. But I do think that there could be a connection between our much higher damages amounts and the jury getting that, as opposed to in other places where there are juries.
So we heard a lot of pros of jury trials. Should we be encouraging them? And is there a way to do that?
Well, so I mean, look, I'm not particularly pro or particularly anti-jury trial, I think, right? I do think that one thing you can think about is how to sort of filter cases that get to the jury, right? And part of that's what I said earlier. What is it? What cases is it in which we'd actually learn something useful from a jury? There's a factual dispute here, or there's some judgment that's required that we think the public would should have some input in. You know, there are various ways to do it, and we've seen some of those filtering processes go on. So Colleen mentions damages, right, and the role of the judge in Daubert as gatekeeper has been increased significantly in the last 10 years, and I think that's probably a good thing, right? It's not to say juries don't get to decide damages. The juries do get to decide damages, but we want to structure the information they're given in ways that their decision is going to be productive rather than either throwing darts at a board or hearing numbers that are as far apart as possible. I think you may do something similar with the summary judgment and 12b6 process, right? Jury trials are expensive. We don't want every patent case to go to a jury trial. We'd like to have the cases that are difficult, that turn on some difficult factual issue, go to a jury trial. But we'd also like to weed out the ones that are simpler beforehand. And there's a particularly strong reason to do that, right? Which is that the high cost of patent litigation is driving a business model that's based on cost of defense settlements. And the more expensive it is to resolve a case on the merits, the more incentive there is for people to pop up with bad patents and say, oh, you know what? Yeah, you could invalidate my patent, but it's going to cost you $2 million or $5 million. Pay me $200,000 instead. Pay me $50,000 instead. And that business model is surprisingly and, frankly, depressingly common. If there's a way to kind of weed out the bad cases early and cheaply enough while still kind of sending the significant cases to a jury trial, I'm all for it.
So we were going to talk about how to improve jury trials, but I thought that the judges this morning did such a fantastic job on that, we should just open it up to questions. So.
We'll start with you, and then...
Hi. What do you think about the main reason of jury's tendency of pro-patentee?
So assuming David's not right, then it's all driven by selection effects, and that's always a possibility. I think there are a couple of possible explanations. I do think juries tend to be unwilling to second-guess the patent office, at least on decisions the patent office has specifically made. So empirical data that John Allison and I have generated shows, for instance, if you argue the patent office made a mistake, you almost never win as a defendant. Where you win in validity challenges is by bringing evidence that wasn't before the patent office and saying, hey, you know, if only the patent office had known about this piece of prior art, they'd have come to a different conclusion. That might or might not be true, but that's a story the jury can get its mind around. It doesn't like the idea that there's a scientific expert agency and we, the non-scientist jurors, are going to second guess it. So I think that's a significant part of it. I don't know whether there's, and we haven't done the numbers to break out whether there's a similar infringement difference or not, although I kind of feel like after Markman, infringement is not the sort of issue the jury ends up resolving in critically in as many cases.
I also think that in addition to what Mark said, you know, also thinking about a patent with this ribbon on it that is in front of the jury, I mean, the presumption is that this is valid. So it's the job of then the other side to convince the jury to kind of have the confidence to overcome this decision. But there's also a personal component where I think, and you can see this in Mark's data a little bit, that juries are also more sympathetic towards inventors and the inventor story, and it's very American to kind of think about the inventor kind of coming up with this great idea, whether it's in a company or elsewhere, but having a face on it as opposed to this kind of corporate infringer, I think there is more sympathy that just from a personal perspective and just being able to identify with the inventor. But
you also have Judge Young holding up his hands.
Right. Well, so I will note one other factor, and you can consider this for what it's worth. Jennifer Urban and Sue Lee and I found in a study a couple of years ago that among district judges deciding summary judgment, the more experience a district judge has with patent cases, the more likely they are to rule for the defendant. And you can come up with a variety of explanations for that, right? Some good, some bad, some kind of neutral, right? But one, at least one explanation that would be consistent with the jury's story is the kind of, you know, the newness effect, right? The first time somebody shows up in your courtroom and says, I invented the internet and all I want is 1%, right? You're inclined to believe them when the government has put a ribbon on it and said, yeah, this is true. The 15th time someone shows up in your courtroom and says, I invented the internet and all I want is 1%, you might be more skeptical. And that would be a reason why a jury just sort of, you know, would be more inclined to a patentee than somebody who's kind of heard it before many times.
I ask you to assume that you don't have constitutional constraints and you don't have constraints of what's politically doable. In that circumstance, given we have 330 million people in a $17 trillion economy, what process would you invent that you think would yield a neutral, objective decision demonstrating comprehension in the most time, cost-effective way? How do you fix it if you had your own way to do it?
He doesn't think it's
why are they all looking at me?
I think one gap that we would say, if you said, like, again, we have carte blanche, we can reinvent the system. One way that the system doesn't seem to be working well is by servicing those with low plaintiffs without a lot of resources, right, because of the cost of litigation is high. On either side, actually, plaintiffs or defendants who are either trying to get their day in court, can't afford it, and will have to kind of resort to other options, or a defendant who can't defend a case in court who thinks this is not a good case, I'm not guilty here, but I've got to settle it. So I think that portion of those who would be seeking more time in the enforcement system could be addressed better by something that we invented. Now, what that new system looks like, I think there's some thinking going on about that, whether it be kind of discussions around small claims court, and the PTO put out a request for comments a couple years ago, and this idea has been out there in IP enforcement in general. So I haven't kind of gotten to that point, but I do think a system that's more equitable, where it's not about the cost of litigation, is one where, you know, where we need to be moving towards.
Yeah. No, I mean, I just was going to say, I agree the cost of litigation, the fact that such a small percentage of cases reach trial, and a lot of that's because the cost of litigation, which affects plaintiffs and defendants, does seem to be, like, a major issue.
Got a last question from John.
Yeah, I just wanted to push back a little bit on one of the things you said, Mark, you know, on the appropriateness of juries vis-a-vis experts. What's been my experience at these trials, you know, you have experts on both sides, whether it's an infringement issue or a validity issue, and they are saying the opposite thing, right? One is saying A and one is saying not A. And I think it's been my experience that juries are particularly adept at looking at those two things happening in front of them. And they're going to look at one expert's credentials versus another, like who's really qualified and who's just an expert, who's just testifying, who's just a regular repeat testifier versus who's an expert in the field, and then through cross-examination expose weaknesses in the positions. And I think juries are particularly appropriate for saying, hey, this expert is credible and this one is not. Even though they're professors from prestigious universities, oftentimes they're in there advocating rather than giving a neutral position. Don't you think juries are good at that?
So I think juries are good at evaluating credibility of witnesses, and I think that includes credibility of expert witnesses. And the question, I think, is really whether what we end up evaluating sort of ends up tied to the substantive merits of the case, right? That is, what I worry is that juries will do an excellent job of picking the best expert witness, but not necessarily the expert witness who has the best scientific argument. But that said, I take your point, and to the extent that that we can actually tell, right, who has a stronger scientific argument by the kind of behavior or how credible the expert witness is, then that's definitely something that the jury's good at.
But if the lawyers are doing their job on both sides, I mean,
yes, right. Although, I mean, you know, I think part of, part of the problem, so let me give you one example, right? Let's imagine two experts, one of whom kind of does their own work and one of whom kind of signs what the lawyer puts in front of them. I'm inclined to think that a jury's going to see that. They're going to pick it out. They're going to like the guy who does their own work. And I'm also inclined to think, generally speaking, maybe that guy's more likely to be right, but it's not obvious that those two are correlated, right? So that it might be that the one who has sort of had the stuff put in front of him actually has a right on the science. And I'm not sure that the jury's going to sort of dig into the science to do it. But of course, you know, maybe nobody in the system is going to be able to do that. So.
Well, with that obvious decision on jury trials, problem solved,
right?
Thank you very much.